School of Mechanical Engineering, we are having two wind tunnels, right? One is low speed wind tunnel, right? Another is high speed wind tunnel, that is known as supersonic wind tunnel. So I will give you some detailed view, what all the things are there, what is basic difference between these two, and what will happen to the flow behavior, right? Within the test section of these tunnels, right? So we will see that. And apart from that, I will give you some slight, introduction about other kind of wind tunnels which are available, right, across the world. All right. So if we look at the objective of wind tunnel, why do we need it? Basically, wind tunnel is required to simulate the flow field about the given object which is moving through the air, right? Theoretically, we can, find out easily all the aerodynamic forces, because we already know from aerodynamic concept all theoretical formulations, right, to find out the net aerodynamic forces acting on that particular object. So theoretical calculations can be done separately. Also, theoretical calculation, whatever you are doing there, you are assuming the ideal conditions. So whatever parameters that you will be getting out of theoretical calculations, those will be the maximum possible values, right? But those may not be real values when that object is moving through the air. So we need to simulate the actual flow phenomena over that particular object in actual environment, where basically compressibility effects may also come and density variation may also come based on the different temperatures, right? But usually in theoretical history till now, whatever things you studied in aerodynamics, we assumed like it is an incompressible flow domain and viscosity has a very negligible effect, right, over the aerodynamic forces. That's what we actually assumed till now. But definitely density variation and viscosity variation or viscosity effects will play a dominant role, right, particularly on aerodynamic forces, right? They may reduce the lift and they will increase the drag. So that difference in results, what you will get in real time scenario will be the actual parameter, actual values. And theoretically, whatever you get, that is the maximum value. Then you will compare the real values, what you are getting, with the theoretical value to find out the effectiveness of your projectile or the vehicle which is moving through the air. So the basic purpose is we need to create a controlled air environment. Why do we need a controlled air environment? Because we want to make our problem steady. Because whenever you're analyzing any open system, you have to keep your whatever domain that you are selecting steady. Right, steady means flow parameter which is traveling through it should have a constant property at a given time. So they should not vary with the time, but across the length there may be variation in properties. That is the basic standard assumption, right, when we are analyzing any open system. So the objective of wind tunnel is to simulate the actual flow phenomena over a particular object in a controlled air environment, and also to measure the forces, moments, pressure, shear stresses, heat transfer, right, as well as velocity, pressure, vorticity, temperature. Because in aerodynamics, we started with the basic definition of flow, then flow velocity vector we defined, and based on the velocity vector, we came to know that there may be a vorticity due to the change in velocity, because a velocity will have three components. If we are talking about three-dimensional flow field, it will have three different velocity components across the three different directions. So if any difference in velocity is present in any perpendicular direction, that will lead to the generation of vorticity. Right? Whenever vorticity comes into the picture, right, that will basically, what it will do, it will disturb the pressure distribution around that particular object. When pressure distribution is going to disturb, due to which there will be an unbalanced force acting over the object. And that unbalanced force may be lift, may be drag, depending on the direction in which we are getting that unbalanced potential operations. All right. So the basic idea here also is to simulate the flow and also to find out all the aerodynamic forces. Those may be lift, drag, side forces, maybe how much heat transfer is taking place due to this flow and structure interactions. Right, these all parameters will usually be calculated in real-time scenario. So if you look at the diagram, this is just a schematic diagram. This is the test section, right, where you will get a uniform flow and with control parameters. And this is the model which will be mounted only in test section. This is a test section, right? And this is the which we will mount the model. And this balance will be connected to sensors, right? Those sensors will since the forces, right, basically in our wind tunnel, we are having basically load cell, and load cell will directly measure the forces, right? So all the forces can easily be calculated, lift, drag, and side forces. Easily you can find out it from the control console, where digital display is there. Directly you can get the values in our wind tunnel. Manually also you can find it out. These can be connected with other monitoring device, where we can get the values out of it. All right, so majority of experimental data, if we want to get the experimental data, we need a control environment. The control environment will be generated only in a wind tunnel. So majority of experimental data for aerodynamic study will be generated from the wind tunnels. So wind tunnels are the devices which provide airstream flowing under controlled conditions, so that the models of interest can be tested using them. And from operation point of view, wind tunnels are generally classified as two categories: low speed, high speed, and special purpose tunnels. Right. So special purpose means we will have a automobile wind tunnel, especially, and full scale aircraft wind tunnel. Like NASA is having full scale aircraft wind tunnel, where prototype directly can be tested instead of model. Here in our wind tunnel, right, we are testing only models, right? That is called reduced scale, a model of a given prototype. But NASA is having a very big wind tunnel, where you can test full scale prototype. Similarly, automobile tunnels are there, where directly you can test the actual prototype of the cars or trucks. Directly can be tested there. So those are special purpose tunnels. So types of tunnels, based on the airflow velocity in the test section, you can classify them into various categories, right? Subsonic wind tunnel, right, whose velocity is less than, usually we say less than Mach 1, but for the practical purpose, we assume if the test section velocity is less than 0.9 Mach will be considered as subsonic wind tunnel. Then transonic comes, right? Transonic range, it is between 0.8 and 1.8, right? So if velocity of the flow in test section is between this range, will be called transonic wind tunnel. Supersonic beyond 1.5, right, value, anything, right, will be called supersonic up to Mach 2 or 2.5 we can go. Then hypersonic comes greater than 5, right? Cryogenic, particularly this we are not using in aerodynamic study. This we will be using for testing the propellants, particularly used in the propulsion, right? So in cryogenic means where temperature value will be very, very low, right? Inside the test section, our temperature control will be below 0 degree. It may go up to minus 44. It may still go up to minus 100 degrees Celsius within that test section. So when we are studying the ice, formation characteristic over a particular aircraft at particular altitude, because we know from atmosphere study, as altitude increases, right, our temperature decreases. So a point will reach, right, especially in the case of space vehicles, right, which crosses more than 100 kilometers above the Earth atmosphere, right? So where freezing or icing across the wing may take place. So to actually identify how much formation of ice will take place at particular altitude, those situations may be actually simulated in the cryogenic tunnel, where we can control the temperature corresponding to the altitude, and we'll see what is the effect of icing over the surface. So for that purpose, we use the cryogenic wind tunnel. Then special purpose wind tunnels further divided into two categories, right? Automobiles, environmental, that icing, buildings, right? You can test the actual prototype of building or it's called small scale models of a buildings to find out the optimized design for a particular building, right? So these are the various classifications of wind tunnels. Then if we look at the wind tunnel layout, right, particularly if you look from outside, they can be divided into four categories: closed return, right, where a certain mass of air will be continuously rotating, right, across the various parts of the wind tunnel, right? So there will be no entry from outside, right? So a fixed mass of air already will be filled inside the tubes, and that will be rotating continuously. Second one is open return, right? Open return means it will either suck the air from the atmosphere, or it may blow the air outside from the wind tunnel. That is called open return. Then double return and annual return. These are the four different categories. One by one, we will see how do they look like. So first case, this is the closed return open circuit wind tunnel. So look at the geometry. This is the top view basically, and this is the side view. This is the example of Boeing subsonic wind tunnel, right? It has been taken from Boeing website, right? Here source is also mentioned. So if you look at the geometry particularly from top view, this is the area where we'll have a control environment that is called test section. So test section will be attached here. All right. And this is the diffuser section. Immediately after that, flow has to be diffused, right? Then it will go through these are the guide vanes basically. Why do we provide the guide vanes? Because air has to turn, right? So if you are turning the air all of a sudden, right, there will be losses involved. Pressure loss will occur. Once the pressure loss occurs at each corner, we will not be having sufficient flow velocity at the test section. To avoid those losses, right, particularly these guide vanes are fixed here. These are the guide vanes basically. Those will guide the flow to turn smoothly, right? So through these, the flow will come. Then finally, we have provided a fan here. So what fan will basically do? It will blow the velocity. It will blow the air at high velocity, right? For that purpose, it is here. This one, and also it will provide the suction effects also, right? Because we have to make the flow to circulate across these channels, right? So this is the your what is a fan, and fan is attached with a motor. Right, then it will go like this. If you look at this particular portion, right, this portion here, flow will basically accelerate, right? Accelerate here. Then after that, it comes here. These are the things which are provided here. Honeycomb structure will be there. Why do we need honeycomb structure? Because we need a uniform flow right in the test section. So the moment when we are accelerating it, chances are there flow may get circulatory motions right in this section. And now it has to become uniform flow, and we want to make it very streamlined flow so that each layer should follow a particular defined path. So for that purpose, we are using the honeycomb structure here, which is provided here, right? Through which when air enters, right, it will come like a uniform parallel flow, right? Then it enters into the convergent section. This is a convergent section, right, whose area is decreasing. So the moment it's entering into the convergent section, what will happen to the flow? Its velocity will basically increase, right? Velocity will increase, right, further. Then this is the test section, right, where your model is mounted, right? So over that flow will happen, right? Then finally it enters into the diffuser, right? In diffuser, velocity decreases. Then again, process continues. So here basically we are not taking air from outside. Already air has been generated right inside, and it is circulating throughout this section. So this is the side view, right, of the same wind tunnel, right? Here the test section. Convergent, this portion is there, then divergent portion is available, and this is the motor, right? 400 horsepower motor is attached, right, to make the flow to happen here. Second is open return, right? In open return, opening will be there through which we can suck the air or we can blow the air, right? Two kind of wind tunnels are there, suction type and blowing type, right? And here also motor is attached here, right? 15 HP dual centrifugal blower is here, right? Which will blow the air. So this is a blowing type of wind tunnel. It will blow the air from here, and air will come out from this screen. So this is the test section again here, right? It is a tubular test section, right? 18-inch diameter, right? This is a diffuser, and this is the convergent portion, and this is having contraction ratio, right? 25:1. Contraction ratio is nothing but exit area to the throat area. So this is the exit area, and this is the throat area. So ratio is 25:1. All right. And from here, flow basically will come into the tunnel, right? So this can operate in dual ways, right? It may be either suction type or blowing type. When it's a suction type, air flow will come through this screen basically. This screen is the honeycomb structure through which air flow will come, and here your model will be mounted, right? And finally, it will go through these exhausts, right? And it can also be working like a blowing type, right? It can blow the air from this side, and air will come out from here. So dual purpose can be served with the open return configuration. So if you look at this, this is a double return, right? This image I have taken from University of Washington Aeronautical Laboratory. The name of this tunnel is Kerston Wind Tunnel, right? So if you look at the geometry of it, right, it is having dual return, right? Double return means from two sides flow will be entering into the test section, right? So look at one fan is attached here, another fan is here. These are the blowers, right? Particularly, they will blow in this direction, and in this direction air is coming, and finally they are coming here. These are all guide vanes, right, which are attached here to reduce the losses in the flow, right? So from one blower line, this is flow is coming like that, then it's entering into the test section. Here the test section where you are mounting your model, right? Here your model will be mounted, and from this side also same kind of flow will be coming, right, through this blower, and finally they will mix here, right? And resultant flow will be traveling over the model, and then it comes here, then gets divided into two equal parts, right? And process continues, right? Process continues. So basically, we are not sending anything out of wind tunnel here. It's closed basically, and but it is having double return. All right, double return of wind tunnel. This is the one configuration. Next configuration is I have taken from NASA website, right? It's the annular wind tunnel, right? If you look at the annular wind tunnel, it is having some cylindrical kind of shape, right? Exterior, surface. If you look at, these are completely closed, right? We are not taking anything from outside, and this is the deflector, right? Which will deflect the flow in two directions, right? Particularly, it will go like this, and it will go like this, and flow has to come from this side, right? This side, because we have mounted the model. All right, this is my test section, right? This is the test section where we are mounting the model. So flow has to enter through this screen, right? This is a screen. This is also a honeycomb structure, right, to make your flow uniform. All right. So this is the deflector which deflect the flow. Whatever flow is coming from here, divided into two parts, right, will go through these openings, right? You look at this geometry particularly. It has been designed in such a way that initially it is a convergent, then it is a divergent. And convergent divergent nozzle is basically, this is working like a nozzle. So nozzle is required to accelerate the flow. So flow will accelerate, then enters through this screen, then again goes through convergent and divergent, right? On both sides, the same kind of geometry is present, right? Geometry is present. So let's suppose the flow is not building up. You can take some air from outside through this opening, right? That opening has been provided. But it will not be always open, right? It will be opened only when flow is not developing that much velocity, then it will suck the air from the outside. And those screens are provided. The purpose of a screen is nothing but they will make your flow uniform, right? Without any rotation, and they will come inside that. So full scale prototypes, right, can be tested under this, right? This kind of wind tunnel. So this is the actual picture of it. This was the schematic. This is the actual picture, right? It was used. Look at the date, right? 15th March 1929. This is variable density tunnel, annular type. This is the annular type. This is the outer skin, right? And here is the text section where scientists are standing, right? They are viewing the flow, how actually it is taking place, and also measuring the forces and all through this console, right? So air flow will be happening like I explained here in the schematic diagram. It is similar like this. Geometry is inside. So this is the annular type of wind tunnel. So today basically we'll start with the low speed wind tunnel. So we have seen there are two kind of wind tunnel, high speed and low speed, right? So any wind tunnel whose test section velocity is less than 0.9 Mach number will be considered low speed. If it is crossing that, right, then it's a high speed wind tunnel. So in a high speed wind tunnel, your transonic wind tunnel, then your supersonic wind tunnel, hypersonic wind tunnels will come into that category, right, of high speed wind tunnels, right? Then special purpose tunnels are also there, right? Those will be depending on special purpose. Like if you are testing automobile vehicles, you have to go for automobile tunnels. If you want to test full scale, right, aircraft, then you have to go for the particular full scale wind tunnel, right, for testing that particular prototype. So if you come to the low speed wind tunnel, right, low speed wind tunnels are those with test section speeds less than 650 kilometer per hour or 180 meter per second, right? So depending on the test section size, they are referred to as small or full scale tunnels, right? And if you again subdivide them, right, they can be divided into two categories based on the flow behavior, right? ओपन सर्किट टनल ऑलरेडी यू यू हैव सीन दी स्कीमेटिक डायग्राम ऑफ दैट राइट. देर इज नो गाइड वेन रिक्वायर्ड बिकॉज फ्लो विल बी एंटरिंग एंड लीविंग दी ट्यूबुलर सेक्शन डायरेक्टली, सो लॉसेस आर लेस. देन क्लोज्ड सर्किट और रिटर्न फ्लो टनल्स राइट वायर यू नीड गाइड वेल्स बेसिकली राइट टू अवॉइड दी लॉसेस राइट. बट इट विल हैव ए कंटिन्यूस फ्लो ऑफ एयर इन साइड. वंस यू एंटर द फ्लो इट विल बी कंटिन्यूसली रोटेटिंग थ्रू आउट दी सर्किट राइट. सो टू टाइप्स यू कैन बेस्ड ऑन द फ्लो बिहेवियर यू कैन डिवाइड इन टू पार्ट राइट. एंड बेस्ड ऑन द साइज ऑल्सो यू कैन से इट इज ऑफ टू टाइप्स राइट. इट्स फुल स्केल एंड स्मॉल स्केल विंड टनल्स. And keep in mind this value, right? Already I mentioned any test section velocity less than 0.9 will be considered as low speed wind tunnel. So if you look at the open circuit wind tunnel, look at various parts of wind tunnel. This is the first part that is called effuser, basically effuser. Then test section comes where you will mount your model, right? Then this is the diffuser section, right? Diffuser section at the end, your fan is attached with a motor, right? Because this is needed to make your flow to happen at a particular velocity. Otherwise, what will happen? Why do we need this motor, right? This is needed because inside this, test inside this tunnel, there will be a lot of losses, right? There may be a frictional losses, there may be a pressure losses, there may be a heat losses. Because of that, what will happen? Your flow velocity by which flow was traveling inside this test section will decrease, right? Over a period of time. To make up the same speed, right? We need some external device to maintain the flow. For that purpose, we are using this motor and fan combination, right? At the end. So, as I mentioned, this can serve two purpose, right? Maybe blowing type, right? Either you can take loose like this, and it will be blowing, right? This will be blowing air, and flow will be going in this direction, or it may be a suction type. So, it is sucking the air, and that's why flow is coming towards the fan. So it is a suction type. Our wind tunnel that we are having at Shastra, it is a suction type wind tunnel, right? Where it will suck the air through this screen, right? Through this screen, air will come and it will be flowing over the test section model, right? And we will calculate all the things. And this is the diffuser, right? Where flow will basically accelerate, right? Accelerate and finally it will go out, right? Through the atmosphere, through this fan. So totals, parts are effuser, right? Which is needed. Why? What the purpose of effuser? What it will do? It will make your flow uniform first and with the required velocity, right? It's a convergent thing is there, right? So when convergence come into the picture, right? What happens to the pressure increases, but velocity will increase. Why? Velocity will decrease basically here. So when velocity is decreasing, why basically we are decreasing velocity? Because we want to make the flow uniform. And uniformity will come only at constant velocity. There should not be any fluctuation, right? So we are decreasing the velocity, then uniform flow enters into the test section, right? Then finally it comes here, accelerate, and goes out of the tunnel geometry through this opening. So these are the basic parts of our wind tunnel. So if you look at this closed circuit, already I explained that closed circuit already sufficient air is filled inside, right? Then it's getting circulating throughout the test section, throughout the section, right? Throughout the circuit. And to avoid the losses at the corners, particularly we are using the guide vanes. So the turning should be smooth, right? That's what is expected. If turning is smooth, losses will be less. If it is turning is all of a sudden turn, air is getting turned, there will be pressure loss, right? Once pressure loss is happening, we will not have a sufficient flow velocity at the test section, right? So here we attach the fan with the motor. Right, and which will make the flow to happen throughout the circuit. Right here, the test section where we will mount the model. Right, and all the corners we are attaching the guide vanes. So, compared to the open circuit, what we say the maintenance will be more in the case of closed circuit wind tunnel, and it is slightly complex, right, to construct. So, construction cost will also be high, right? Construction cost will also be high. So even though we are using guide vanes, still some pressure losses will be there that cannot be make as zero, right? So some losses will be there compared to open circuit wind tunnel. So both open circuit and closed circuit wind tunnels can operate with either open jet or closed jet, right? And their cross section, particularly test section, cross section may be either cylindrical. In tubular case, right, it will be a cylindrical, it may be a rectangular, it may be elliptical or octagonal. Any shape of test section can be adapted, right? So in low speed wind tunnels, the predominant factor, if you look at, will be the inertia and viscosity, right? Even though we are neglecting the viscosity in theoretical analysis, but it has to be considered in real flow simulation. So in low speed, particularly, viscosity will play a dominant role, right, in calculating the aerodynamic forces. So two forces basically will dominate, that is inertia and viscosity. And effect of compressibility usually we neglect because at low speed there will be no appreciable change in density. So we will say compressibility effects are negligible in the low speed wind tunnel. So if you want to test the model, right, you have to compare the Reynolds number of actual model, that is called prototype, and your model, that is the reduced scale prototype. So if you compare the Reynolds number, let's suppose a full scale prototype is having Reynolds number some value. If you are able to generate same Reynolds number with the model, then whatever aerodynamic forces you are calculating on the model will also be the aerodynamic forces on the prototype, right? So that is the basic logic we consider when we are going for experimentation of a reduced scale model. So Reynolds number of experimental model and full scale prototypes are equal, that you need to take into account. So when that condition exists, then viscosity effects will be very, very less, right? At that case, we can say effect of viscosity is negligible. If you look at the high speed wind tunnel, already explained, any test section velocity higher than this threshold value, that is 650 kilometer per hour, will be considered as high speed wind tunnel, right? The predominant aspect, right, like we were not considering the compressibility effect in low speed wind tunnel, but in high speed wind tunnel we need to consider the compressibility effect. So every parameter that you will be calculating in high speed wind tunnel will be in terms of Mach number, right? So this means that in high speed flows it is essential to consider Mach number as a more appropriate parameter than the velocity. In low speed wind tunnel we will be talking only everything in terms of flow velocity, but in high speed wind tunnel we will be considering the Mach number as one of the important parameters, right? A lower limit of high speed might be considered to be flow with Mach number approximately 0.5, right, at standard sea level conditions. So in some of the practical applications, right, scientists have identified that even a flow with a Mach number 0.5 can also be considered as high speed wind tunnel, because they have got high speed flow right in the test section even at Mach number 0.5. This is the local flow Mach number that I am talking about, at which they got the high speed flows in the test section area. That can also be considered high speed flow. If we look at the general features, right, of the wind tunnel, already from the schematic diagram you have seen, any wind tunnel will have these four components, right? Effuser, then working or test section, then diffuser, and one driving unit is also needed, right, to make continuous flow across the wind tunnel. So if you look at the effuser, this is a converging passage, right, located upstream of the test section. In this passage, what will happen? Your flow will basically accelerate, right? Because from starting, flow velocity will be less, right? When it's sucking the air from outside, flow velocity will be less, right? Then it will accelerate through the conversion section, right? But not that much velocity, right? At the end, what will happen? There will be a screen also, right? Before it, a screen will be there. So flow will become uniform. Then velocity will take place. Why do we need that slight increase in velocity? The moment flow is coming inside the wind tunnel, right, boundary layer formation will take place because of the viscosity. To counter that effect, some increment in upstream velocity is needed. For that purpose, conversion section is provided, right? So it also will increase the turbulency, right? The moment is entering, because of the formation of boundary layer, some circulatory flow may be enhanced, right? So even though that strength will be less, right, so that strength will be reduced, right, based on the area ratio. So at inlet and throat, that area ratio, if you change, the magnitude of turbulency will decrease, right, will decrease. So that is called contraction ratio. Contraction ratio is nothing but area at entry, right, and area at exit of convergent cone. So contrast ratio usually for low speed wind tunnel, right, will be in the range of 4 to 20, right? 4 to 20. So in general, the fissure contains honeycomb structure, right, to make your flow uniform. Or if honeycomb structure is not there, then wire gauges will be there to reduce the turbulence, because we don't need turbulency in the flow, right, when it's entering into the test section to produce air uniform airspeed. Then test section comes. It is the heart of your wind tunnel, basically, where you will find all the required aerodynamic forces, right? So the portion of wind tunnel with constant flow characteristics across the entire section is termed as test section or working section. So as boundary layer has formed right along the test section walls, so the walls are given suitable divergence, right? So that net cross-sectional area should be uniform, because in test section, if you look at your boundary layer will be forming. So when boundary layer is forming, it will be making convergent kind of section, right, inside the test section of a wind tunnel. To counter that, basically some divergence usually provided at the boundary of the test section to make your area approximately constant. So we'll have a approximately constant uniform flow across the test section. So if the test section is boundary is rigid, if it is closed by a rigid boundary, in our wind tunnel you will find all boundaries are rigid, right? That is called closed throat tunnel, right? Closed throat tunnel. If it is not bounded, right, and it is just bounded by the airflow is taking place, and all boundaries are open basically. And your test in test section you have mounted the model, so model is mounted in open state, right? All boundaries are open, and through that air is going out, right? So air flow will be making the boundaries of it. That is called as open jet tunnel. Open jet tunnel. So if you look at the diffuser, right, the diffuser is used to reconvert the kinetic energy into the pressure energy, right? So diffuser is used to reconvert the kinetic energy of the air leaving the working section into the pressure energy, right? Then that high pressure energy will cross the boundary and comes out into the atmosphere in the case of open circuit. If it is a closed circuit, it will again go into the fan, will increase, then pressure energy will convert into the kinetic energy, then again process will continue in a similar way. So essentially it's passes in which the flow decelerate with so in diffuser section it will decelerate. So we make the diffuser angle also very very small to avoid any kind of boundary formation, boundary layer formation into diffuser section. So in your fluid mechanics you will study about this in Venturi meter in the sixth chapter, that the divergence section cannot cross 5 degree in any case. If you are crossing 5 degree divergence angle, in that case what will happen, there will be a formation of boundary layer in the divergence section. If that is going to be happen, there will be loss, more losses, right, in the flow, right, in the divergence section. If that happens, that will also have direct impact over the test section velocity. Here the exit of the cross section will be circular to accommodate the fan, right? Like you have seen here in open circuit, fan is also attached. So here this cross section will be circular, right? But here it may be either rectangular or it may be octagonal, but at the end it will be a circular. So flow is getting decelerated here, right? It is accelerating here, right, in the convergence section. Here it is a decelerating. So that is about test section diffuser. Last is driving unit. Why do we need driving unit to make your flow continuous flow in the test section? Why that is needed? If we are removing it, right, after some time what will happen, flow will decelerate because of losses involved. What are those losses? Losses due to friction, due to presence of viscosity, losses due to heat transfer rate across the test section wall, and several other losses, right, eddies and turbulence, and due to which some losses may occur, right? To counter those all losses, right, we attach usually a motor to make uniform flow, right, across the wind tunnel, right, across the wind tunnel. So what are the different losses in the wind tunnel, right? You can sub-categorize them into various category. So total power losses in wind tunnel may be split into the following components: losses in the cylindrical parts, right, and losses in the guide vanes at the corner if you are talking about the closed circuit tunnels, losses in the diffuser, losses in contraction cone, right, that is in the fissure section, and losses in a honeycomb, right, skeins and so on. and losses in the test section due to the jet losses in the case of open jet. If it is an open jet, right, some airflow will come out, right, because boundaries are not rigid. In that case, some losses may involve. Losses in the exit in the case of open circuit tunnel, some losses may involve the moment air flow is leaving the tunnel and mixing with the airstream. So these are the various losses, right, in actual scenario. Those usually we neglect when we are doing the theoretical analysis, right? So that's why actual data, what you are getting are the real data, and those need to be, you know, compared with the theoretical data to find out the overall, what we say, the effectiveness of a particular object, a particular trajectory moving through the air. So this is the image, right, of our wind tunnel that is available at the Shastra, right? So look at this design. So this is the effusor section, right? This is the test section where you will mount the model, right? Mount the model, and this model will be attached with the small tubing to this multi-vanc manometer. You see here, manometer is there. This is a multi-vanc manometer, right? Directly you can measure the pressure difference across the surface of the object. Once you know the pressure difference across the surface of the object, you can plot the pressure distribution. That is called coefficient of pressure across the length of the object. You can plot. That is called pressure contour. And from pressure contour, you can easily find out the aerodynamic forces, right, moment, whatever aerodynamic forces will come. Side forces can also be calculated by measuring the pressures, right, across the length of the object. So across the length of the object, what basically you will do, you will make small holes, right? Those are called static pressure ports, and those static pressure ports will be connected via tubes, right, to this multi-vanc manometer. So you look at here, we are having around 25 ports. You can go up to 25 ports across the surface of object, and you can connect to these tubings, right? So we are having 25 tubings here, right? And one tube, if you look at this single tube, which is going like that and is connecting somewhere at exit of this test section. So this is called free stream pressure condition, right? Free stream pressure condition. And look at this instrument, which is attached here. This is called pitot tube, right? Pitot tube, which will measure the flow velocity, right? And this is also connected with the two tubes, right? You look at this here, the two tubes are there. One will measure the total pressure, another will be measure the static pressure. Due to this difference of pressure, right, your dynamic pressure will be sensed, and the dynamic pressure will convert into the flow velocity directly. You can read from here. So this is the console where you will get the flow velocity. And if you want to get overall lift force and side force, right, and load cell is also attached, right, this model is mounted here. Model will be mounted over the load cell, right here. Load cell is, and load cell is directly, you know, connected to the console. So you can get the lift force with this digital indicator, and lift and drag can be taken from here, right? From here, this is the flow velocity indicator, and this is the side force indicator, right? Side force indicator. And this one, if you look at this console, right, this digital indicator, this will indicate your RPM of this fin. Because you will be rotating the fan, then only there will be flow establishment in the test section. So this digital indicator will give the RPM, right, at which this fan is rotating, right? And this console will give the flow velocity, right, in the test section. And these three indicators, right, digital indicators will give the corresponding forces, right? Forces directly you can measure. If you don't want this, then actual things you can calculate from the pressure distribution, right? Because already static ports you have created over that. So corresponding pressures can be measured, and you can draw the pressure distribution. And out of the pressure distribution, you can find out the forces, right? Either side forces, lift forces, drag force, those all can be calculated easily, right? So by two methods, you can calculate the forces, either via direct measurement or via pressure distribution also you can calculate. So these are the things, right, in the normal, this is open circuit wind tunnel, basically open flow, right? Flow is coming from this side and going out from this exit, right? So this exit here, fan and motor is attached, right? Motor is also attached. So look at the cross section, right? Exit of the diffuser section is a circular, right, in this case, but test section is a rectangular here. So we are having a total 1 meter length of this test section, right, total here, and 30 cross 30 is the 30 centimeter, and 30 centimeter is that cross section of our test section, right? If you cut it, you will find 30 cross 30 as a square kind of test section here. So these are the all things related to the internals. With this, I am closing the today's discussion, right? So if you are having any doubt, you can start asking the doubts.